life that some of the best sermons that God has given me were not the ones that I toiled over for weeks, but the ones that I prayed over day and night. And when you go to the rock, you'll find that he'll make a metamorphosis in whatever you're trying to do. I go to the rock. Where do I go when there's no one there to turn to? Who do I talk to when there's no one else to listen? Who do I lean on, oh Lord, when there's no foundation stable?
I go to the rock.
The solid rock, you better stand. When I need a shelter, when I need a friend, go to the rock. Where can I hide when the storm's passing over? Where can I run to when the storms of life are threatening? Is there a refuge? Lord have mercy. Rock I stand. When I need a shelter, when I need a friend, I go to the rock. Rock, you better stand. When you need a shelter, when you need a friend, go to the rock, the solid rock. He's a doctor in the sick room. He's a lawyer in the courtroom. He's a friend for the friendless. He's a brother for the brother. Dry deserts. Oh, I gotta go. I gotta go. Fall on my knees. Lord, help me, please. You go to the rock. It will never leave you. You go to the rock. Oh, Lord, yeah.
Good evening, everyone.
I find comfort in knowing how much God cares for me. There are times I know we don't know what will happen tomorrow. But I do know who holds tomorrow. And I know who is always there to hold my hand. I have a witness in here this evening. Every step is getting brighter as the golden stairs I climb. Every burden's getting lighter. Every cloud is silver lined. There the sun is always shining. There no tear will dim the eye at the ending of the rainbow. I don't seem to understand, but I know who holds tomorrow, and I know who holds my hand. About tomorrow, it may bring me poverty, but the one who feeds the sparrow is the one who stands by me. Yeah. is my portion. Maybe through the flame or flood, but His presence goes before me. There's any believers in here, just lift your hands. Say, my hand.
Good evening again, everybody. I see even more faces. The Lord has been faithful to many more of us. Amen. Traveling mercies. Has the Lord been good? God has been awesome and good to us, and we are just delighted to tarry in His presence a bit, to sing some songs together, to prepare to hear the Word of God tonight, and for the next few days, amen, to receive some enrichment, some training. Let's just sing that testimony together. God is so good. And then we're going to invite my friend Lakeisha to come share a song after that. God is so good. Let's sing that together. God is so good. You sound beautiful. God is so good. He's so good to me. Now with a big smile, He is my joy. He is my joy. He is. God is my joy. He's so good to. Let's sing one more. I love Him so. I love Him so. Might make you smile too. He's coming soon. He's coming soon. Hallelujah. He's coming soon. He's coming soon.
He's so good to me. I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice
to worship you. Take joy, my King.
Take joy, my King.
In what you hear.
In what you hear.
May it be a sweet, sweet sound.
May it be a sweet, sweet sound in your ear.
Let's sing that one more time.
Oh, I love you, Lord. I love you, Lord.
And I lift my voice. To worship you.
Rejoice.
Take joy.
Take joy, my King,
in what you hear.
In what you hear. May it be a sweet, sweet sound in your
Praise the Lord, everyone. Praise the Lord, everyone. God is truly worthy to be praised. And as the deer pants for the water brook, so my soul thirsts for the living God. Anybody thirsty? Thirsting for his presence, thirsting for his goodness, thirsting for his love. Lord, we thank you. And we're asking for you to fill our thirst, Lord God.
As the deer panteth for the water, so my soul longeth after thee. Alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you. Oh, as the deer panteth for the water, so my soul longeth after thee. Alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship thee. Oh, you alone are my strength, my shield. To you alone does my spirit yield. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship thee.
In my country they say,
même je plante dans le jardin, besoin de l'eau, c'est qu'on s'amoie, soit prêt, sans sou. Ou c'est joie, non que moi, Et moi, pape, j'aime suspend, chanter, gloire, ou, oh, non, ou seul, non, moi, jouer, refuge, non, ou seul, non, moi, jouer, la vie. Joie, non que moi, et moi, pape, j'aime suspend, chanter, gloire, ou, oh, you alone are my strength, my shield, to you alone does my spirit yield. You alone, God, are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Oh Lord, we praise your name. All the glory, all the glory, and all the praise, all the praise. Oh Lord, we praise your name. Oh, hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Oh Lord, we praise your name. We give you all the glory, and all the praise, oh Lord, we praise your name. Can anyone sing hallelujah, 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 hallelujah?
Good evening. As I look at your faces, welcome back home. It's good to see you. We're pleased to present to you the group that last night, yesterday, was declared by the city of Huntsville as Huntsville's Aeolians Choir at Oakwood University Day. We're pleased that you're here, and just to give you a quick synopsis, earlier this year, in fact, last month, our Aeolians went to Baltimore and competed against 105 other historically black colleges and universities. They were the defending national champions, and when they left there, Patrick, they returned as the national champions. In fact, as we like to say here, we are proud of Alabama, Roll Tide, Roll football team, national champions. We're proud of Auburn, but in the state of Alabama, we're the only current back-to-back national college champions. Next month, we will be going to Moscow. No, not Moscow, Indiana. Moscow, Russia. And we need your prayers. But we want you to join us in July. We're having our first ever presidential cruise with Wintley Phipps, with Leslie Pollard, and with the Aeolians. We have posters for each and every one of you to take back to your churches. And I'm not one to want to drop hints, but you may want to suggest to your congregations that they really want to show pastoral appreciation. Cruise with the Sound of Music. Ladies and gentlemen, here in this market, we talk about less talk and more music. I'm pleased to present to you Your My Hour, Aeolians and University Choir, under the leadership of Jason Max Ferdinand.
For obviously tonight, that video is not going to run. Bring me just a bit more sound if we can. Good evening, everybody. One of the powerful things of this Pastoral Evangelism Leadership Conference, and we can go with Come Holy Spirit now, that tune, is the fact that we actually kept the nuance of the thing we had on last year, Pentecost 2. We added a different moniker this year. Not trying to tweak it just to tweak it, but in a recognition that we need to stay right at the heart of the Holy Spirit with this conference. Last year, God honored this conference, but here is a fact about God that we all need to know. God never works the same way twice. And there's an arrogance if you move at things and saying, God, do it again. So he calls upon us at conferences like this to, as we've been doing this whole year, to fall flat on our faces before God and to be asking continuously for his Holy Spirit. I was blessed on Friday morning when I got a call from several pastors in the Lake Region Conference. It's called the Pastoral Prayer Support Group. Those brothers began to call out to God and for the power of the Holy Spirit with a level of intensity that I just had not experienced before. And then at 1 o'clock that afternoon, the whole Pelt Planning team on this past Friday got on the phone, and it was just one of those just rare times where there was just this holy atmosphere of God on the phone. Then this evening at 5:15, the prayer warriors from all over the city of Huntsville, all the churches here, gathered on the floor of the sanctuary, and every corner, every crevice, they began to call out to God and begin to say, Holy Spirit, would you come? Would you rest, rule, and abide? Let me tell you the takeaway for this conference. If you leave on Tuesday night and you're talking about the preacher and you're talking about the musicians, you're talking about the seminars and the vendors, then this will not be successful. But if at the end of Tuesday night's prayer meeting, you're talking about God, then that is the clear evidence that God has honored us with his presence. A few weeks ago, a couple of months ago in our planning session, we introduced a song that we decided as a planning team will become the theme song of this conference. It is more than a song. It really is a prayer. And the words go like this. Put them on the screen if you would for me. Just the words themselves. Just the words. It says, come Holy Spirit. Move in your people. Draw us to Jesus, his glory to see. And rain down from heaven fresh living water. Bring us your liberty. And when we sing it a couple of times through, as it did in our planning meeting, all of the planning stopped that day. There was this holy atmosphere of God that took over the planning meeting. I want you to stand this evening in your place where you are. And before we sing this, let's pray. Father, tonight, God, we just invite your presence here. We thank you, God, that you have promised to be right in the middle when your people join together in your name. God, we just honor you tonight in this place. And tonight, we are not going to sing to each other. We're going to sing to you in the words of a prayer. Come, Holy Spirit, move in your people. Draw us to Jesus, his glory to see. Rain down upon us fresh living water. And then our prayer is that you will bring us your liberty. Listen to the song a couple of times through, then let's sing it together.
With one voice, come Holy Spirit, one voice.
Come Holy Spirit, move in your peace.
rain down from heaven.
Rain down from heaven.
Fresh living water.
Fresh living water.
Bring us your liberty.
Bring us your liberty.
Let's sing that again.
Let's try, everybody. Here we go. Send His Holy Spirit into this place.
Shall we pray? Our gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we bless you in this place. Father, we give you glory and we give you honor. And Father, we ask that you would indeed honor us with your presence tonight. Father, as we come into your presence, we ask that you would cleanse us of all unrighteousness. Wash us and make us clean, O God. Anoint our ears, O God. Give us ears that we may hear what the Spirit is saying. Father, we ask that you would break up the fallow ground in our hearts and our minds, O God, and allow us to hear a word from you, O God. Lord, help us to experience you in new and living ways. Flood our hearts, our minds, our ministries with your power, O God. Don't let us leave here the same way that we came. Recharge us, not just for our churches, but for your kingdom, O God. And Lord, let all that is done here be to your name's honor and glory. Let it be a sweet-smelling savor in your nostrils. And we promise when it's all said and done, we'll give you all the praise, the honor, and the glory. For it's in the worthy name of Jesus we pray. Amen and amen.
Back in the month of August, the regional conference presidents came together, and in a very unanimous vote, God allowed us to choose a brand new leader that leads not only the regional conference presidents caucus, but leads the Office of Regional Conference Ministries. And tonight, it is my privilege and pleasure to bring our welcome tonight, our new caucus leader, Elder Charles Drake, President, Central States Conference. Put your hands together for Dr. Drake.
Good evening, everyone. Isn't it good to be here? It is my privilege, on behalf of the 9 regional conference presidents, the regional coordinators for the Pacific and the North Pacific Union, and the president of the Bermuda Conference, to welcome you to this great conference tonight and this week. We have been doing this for almost 30 years. The regional caucus, the regional conferences represent 308,000 members in North America and 1,200 congregations. So we are happy to be able to sponsor this event year after year, and it is our hope that as you come, as you participate, that you are filled with the Spirit of God, and that that Spirit of God will not stay here when you leave here, but that you will take it with you where you go and ignite the power of God across North America. We have seen miracles happen, and we know that it can happen with each and every one of us who are here tonight. And so we welcome you. Put your hand in the air, your right hand. Put it in someone else's hand. And say, welcome to the best place in the whole wide world. May the Lord bless you real good.
On behalf of Oakwood University, we invite to the pulpit Dr. Timothy McDonald, the provost of Oakwood University. Please welcome Dr. McDonald with a hearty amen.
Thank you, Edel Russell. It's a pleasure to be here and for me to welcome you on behalf of our president, Dr. Leslie Pollard, who will speak to us hopefully, prayerfully by video in just a moment. I want to welcome you on behalf of our 300 faculty and staff and our 2,000 students. Did you get that? 2,006 to be exact. We welcome you. And by the way, we want to thank you for those students because of you, parents and pastors and church workers and conference and union and division workers. If you weren't sending them to us, there wouldn't be a reason for us to be here. So thank you so much. We appreciate your sending the students, your prayers, your financial support for Oakwood University. So gentlemen, are we ready? If you would cue the official welcome from Dr. Pollard. Thank you. Thank you, everybody.
Greetings to each of you, my colleagues. Welcome home to your Oakwood University. And on behalf of the Oakwood faculty, staff, and students, I welcome you to the annual Pastoral Evangelism Leadership Conference. Dr. Drake and the entire regional caucus have invested significant human and financial resources into making this 2011 annual conference the high point of professional clergy development and the premier professional clergy conference in the Seventh-day Adventist Church. My regrets to Pastor Russell and the PELC planning team as well, because I know how much hard work you have put into the planning of this year's conference. I join my colleagues in praying for this year's conference. I especially wanted to both listen in and join the conversation on how we will relate to our clergy colleagues in other faith traditions. This is an important conversation, and we have to get it right for the mission of this church that we all love. Prudence and I regret that we cannot be in attendance this year, but our Oakwood team is preparing for our once per decade accreditation site visit on February 28, 2012, and the President's presence is required at this year's meeting in Orlando, Florida. During last year's conference, right around this same time, Dr. Russell invited Prudence and me to the stage for a special season of prayer in which my colleagues laid hands on us and consecrated us to this mission with prayer. It was a very moving moment in our service and a powerful impetus for our service to this wonderful institution called Oakwood. We assumed our responsibilities on January 3rd, and might I say, we entered to a blinding snowstorm here in Huntsville, Alabama. Colleagues, one day everyone will know about Oakwood University. And instead of 2,000 students, we'll have 5,000 students. God will enlarge Oakwood's territory in ways that we have not imagined. Thank you very much for your support. Oakwood needs strong clergy partners in leadership. So please keep us in your prayer. And when I say, oh, you, I want to hear you say, oh, yes. Now, if you'd like real-time info from me about Oakwood or anything that we're doing, feel free to follow me on Twitter at Les Pollard or on Facebook, Or you may also receive the President's FYI. All you'll have to do is go to our website, www.oakwood.edu, to sign up for President's FYI, and also for our weekly newsletter that we push out called OU, Oh Yes. And may God bless you. And above all, may God bless Oakwood University.
This time I'm going to ask that Linda Pinnock will come. She escorts Paula Johnson, Calvin Watkins, to the pulpit. This evening we have the privilege to honor a true woman of God. Some of you were not even born, or you just were born about 20-something years ago when God planted and deposited within Paula Johnson an idea. The idea was that she understood that that pastors were being ministered to out of this conference, but there was really nothing in place for clergy spouses. It used to be pastors' wives, but now it's clergy spouses for obvious reasons. There was nothing in place to minister to them. Paula, along with a few colleagues, began to meet around, I think it was January, February, at the General Conference building, of where during that winter season, clergy spouses, along with their husbands from around the country, would come in and for 2 or 3 days, just outstanding ministry to those spouses of pastors. And then some years ago, over 15 years ago, Paula began to minister here along with her team, where clergy spouses began to come with their husbands to this event here. And God blessed in immeasurable ways, of where those spouses had their needs met, issues met, as they navigated sometime the tough terrain of ministry. Tonight we are officially making a transition in leadership for our clergy spouses, for Pelk in particular. And then on Tuesday night, we'll make another transition with me and my successor. But tonight, Dr. Charles Drake, our caucus leader, will come tonight to bring some very special things to Paula, as well as some special words in affirming her outstanding ministry to Pelk, as well as clergy spouses in the regional conferences all over this country. Dr. Drake.
Again, we are privileged tonight to honor one of God's sheroes. Sheroes. To Paula Johnson, with grateful appreciation for your passion, dedication to the development and well-being of the North American Division Ministerial Spouses. Well done, good and faithful servant leader. Presented December 4, 2011, Pastors Evangelism and Leadership Conference. Thank you so very much. Most of us have plaques that we can hang on the wall, and they eventually end up in a box. Amen. And so we want to give you something else where you can go and get whatever it is you want. May God bless you so very much.
I just want to say thank you for this recognition, but I want everyone to know that this was not a singular effort at all. Through the cooperation of the ministers, wives, leaders through the years, this has happened. Through the cooperation of the committee that plans the Evangelism Council, this has happened. Through the cooperation of my children through the years, because I sacrificed time away from them, this has happened. Through the sacrifice and help and support of my husband, this has happened. J. Alfred Johnson, you don't know. He's a true supporter, and I thank you for it, honey. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And there are three people who I'd like to definitely acknowledge. And that's the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, because truly, without them, this could not have happened. Thank you very much.
I'm going to ask Linda Pinnock to come forward. And tonight, it is our privilege to introduce you for the very first time, the new clergy spouses leader for the Pelt Conference, Sister Linda Pinnock of Southeastern California Conference. Put your hands together.
What an honor it is to have been chosen to come behind Paula and to walk beside her. Has been just wonderful. She's an excellent leader, wonderful leader. I don't feel that I could walk in her shoes, but I will walk in the shoes of Jesus. Who thought it that over 60 years ago in Germantown, Ohio, where my mother accepted this blessed truth, that I would stand here to represent the wives of the spouses of the ministers and North America Division. Pray for me as I lead God's way. Thank you.
We want to make sure that tonight that you also understand that this meeting did not just happen, but Elder Fred Russell and his team of 12, if you're here, would you please stand? The planning committee, members of the planning committee, would you please stand? And would you give them, Elder Fred Russell and these folk, a good hand tonight? It's already good. Praise the Lord.
Well, we changed the culture a little bit this year. All of a sudden, those folks start charging us a huge amount of money to come, $29. And when you change the culture, when it was given with no cost at all but to get here, sometimes it can be painful. Let me give you the reality of where this conference belongs to all of us. We get a subsidy from the Office of Regional Conference Ministries that comes from all of our conferences. Because of the escalating cost of everything, that subsidy cannot keep pace with the cost of this conference. A few years ago, it would cost $5,000 to do this, $20, $30, $40, $50, $60. Now it's up there. And because that subsidy has stayed level, because there is limited funds to be able to bless all of the entities under the Office of Regional Conference Ministries, we felt a need of 2 years ago, the discussion started, to begin to charge just a nominal registration fee in order to cover the cost of this conference. But we begin to raise the level of the quality of the conference, building on the outstanding leadership of Dr. Warren and those PELT leaders who have come before. And this year, one of the things that you will receive not only with these outstanding super seminars that will take place starting tomorrow and on Tuesday, where you'll be able to attend one of those, but when you go to those seminars, you're going to need tickets in order to get in. Starting tomorrow morning, the only services that will be open to the general public will be the evening services tomorrow night and also the prayer meeting on Tuesday night. But tomorrow morning when you come, in order to get into the sanctuary itself for the morning services, the plenaries, the afternoon plenaries, and even into the super seminars, you will need to have a registration badge on to get into the sanctuary. And then to get into the super seminars, you would have had to register for those seminars and show a ticket in order to get in. Now, these seminars are all going to larger venues to accommodate as far as we can as many people as possible. Now, once they fill up, and some of them are already filled, then you will have an option to go to another seminar of those
5 on tomorrow, which are listed in your program booklet, and the 6 that would take place on Tuesday. And again, the Lord is blessed because 99.9% of you have been very accommodating. You've done it very smoothly. We know $29 is not a lot. However, it does represent a shift. And we appreciate just the smooth, professional way about which you have done this for Pelk on this year. As always, starting on last year, we upgraded the whole bookstore idea that every seminar you go in tomorrow, your presenter, as it did last year, will be encouraging you to get a book that will allow your learning to continue after that super seminar. All of those books are in the bookstore. Then on tomorrow morning and tomorrow evening, I will be pushing other books that will be a blessing to you. We have several authors who will be doing book signings in the bookstore at scheduled times. I want to thank Theron Thomas, who is the ABC manager of the South Central Conference, who is leading out with their team and running the bookstore this year. We have an array of book and tape resources, because remember that your growth cannot stop here. It must continue after this conference is over. The vendors have been selected and chosen this year, again, because of the ministry value that they give. We are not having bake sales. We don't have a lot of other vendors other than ministry-related vendors, that all of the resources and all of the ministry opportunities that they offer will be able to bless you as you go back to your places of ministry when you get home. Bottom line is that tomorrow, starting tomorrow morning, is an absolute time of growth. Everything that you involve yourself in under the areas of equip, you will be able to use it 8 o'clock on the morning that you get back home. We have deleted theory out of everything. Everything must be able to work right now. We chose the faculty for this year with the understanding of the sermons we gave them across the phone is that, guys, no theory. This is a theory-free zone. We go to the universities to get theory. At these praxis and practical conferences, it must be able to use immediately on a pastor arriving back home. You're going to see that tomorrow in our plenaries, from the general plenary here, as well as the ones that will take place. Now, as we did last year, the trains will be running on time with everything. So in the morning, we will be starting exactly at 8 o'clock. Exactly 8 o'clock, and you will watch tomorrow as we stay on time. One of the incredible things that happened last year is that just the level of professionalism just went to an entirely different level. We had almost no one hanging in the halls because of the value that was in these seminars, as well as what was happening in this room. We look for that to be duplicated again this year. Tonight, we hope that you will be blessed as we are trying to bless God himself in his presence tonight. May God bless you as we wait before the Lord tonight. Oh, one other thing. There is a prayer room that was set up this year. Pastor Roy Gator, who is the prayer ministry's coordinator for the South Central Conference, is leading out this year. And over to my right and your left, in the rooms out there, there is a prayer room where a sign is on the door. That is not for everybody. This room is only for pastors and conference personnel and pastoral clergy. This is a time, guys, where you walk in and into this sacred space and in quiet, no one around but a few, where you get a chance just to spend quiet time before God. Because all of us are always giving. We're always giving. But in this conference, this is the time to receive. This is the time to spend time before God, pushing the reset button for your ministry. If you have been in an environment of mediocrity in your ministry, this is the time to say, God, I commit myself to you all over again. Those of you who are preparing to check out when you came here, that this is it for you, you're preparing to walk away, this is the time to allow God to bring that original call back on you all over again. Those of you who have been waning spiritually, you know that for months you have been off your game when it comes spiritually. This is a time, listen to the word again, to push the reset button with God all over again. As opposed to gathering in the hotels this week, playing Rook, this is a time to call a prayer meeting in your room with your colleagues. As opposed to being in the parking lots and referring to folk perhaps you don't care for and colleagues, this is a time to say, God, let me begin to pray for them. Let me bless them. Because life and death is in the power of the tongue. So we're going to bless during this conference. We're going to soak up God's presence. We're going to wait in his presence. We're going to watch what God does simply because we came here. Our services continue as planned this evening.
I was ready to ask for an encore, but they wouldn't let me. But let us give them another rousing amen. In introducing the preacher for the evening, I turn your minds to John the Revelator in his Patmos cell. He catches a vision of his splendid Lord and describes it in part by saying, I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day and heard behind me a great voice as of the sound of a trumpet. I heard a great voice. But then a couple of verses down in that same chapter, Revelation 1, John adds, I turned to see the voice that spoke with me. Hearing the voice versus seeing that voice. To hear a voice merely picks up sound waves scrambling through space. But to see that voice transcends Shakespeare's sound and fury and plummets the depth and power and purpose behind that voice. Please listen up for a brief moment.
One man, one voice, but Herod the king feared John the Baptist. Big and broad-shouldered, with a chest that gave power to a voice that was able to ring through the wilderness hills, this John the Baptist, the people said, Jesus, thou art John the Baptist. We must be changing our opinion of Jesus then. What happened to the weak, frail teacher that we always picture? If the people compared him to Elijah, to John the Baptist, then Jesus must have been a big man, a man of physical and mental stature who commanded the appearance of people as he passed through the street. How is it that we have gotten this present-day picture of Jesus? Skinny martyr, with soft words indeed. Jesus was a man. Can you picture Martin Luther King ringing?
In the words of Thomas Carlyle, an articulate, audible voice of the past. That recording, ladies and gentlemen, allowed us to hear the voice of our speaker while he was a student at Oakwood College in the 1960s. He was preaching at the First Baptist Church here in Huntsville, Minister Horace Snodgrass, pastor. Tonight, like John the Revelator, we are blessed to be transmuted from merely hearing to seeing that voice print, which for decades has been crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord. It is the voice of a university professor. It's the voice of a conference president. It's the voice of a pastor. It's the voice of a husband and father. It's the voice of God's preacher for this keynote service of Evangelism Council 2011. For all who have assembled here for Pentecost 2, walking in the rain, welcome tonight to see the unmistakable voice of Henry Monroe Wright. He's in the house, everyone. He will be in the pulpit following the special music. God bless you.
as it were a sea of glass mingled with fire. And those that had gotten the victory over the beast and over his image and over his mark and over the number of his name stand on that sea of glass, having the harps of God. And they sing the song of Moses, the servant of God, and the song of the Lamb, saying,
who shall not fear thee, oh. The aliens were just at my church a few Sabbaths ago, and we're still swimming in the waters of their glory and of God's glory in them. I am honored to be here. I don't know where they found that tape. That was 48 years ago. I've been in active ministry for 47 years. I couldn't help but reflect sitting there on the bench between Freddie Russell and Calvin Watkins, whom I taught here on this campus. I'm deeply grateful to the Lord. I've taken time to organize a few of my sermons and teaching materials for you, so stop by the table saying Pan de Vida, Bread of Life. That's my table. You may find something there worthwhile. Let me clarify why I'm here this evening. It is not for some human preaching exhibition. If you don't know by now that I can preach, I would not be able to prove it to you in one sermon. I'm here, first of all, because the brethren have been kind enough to invite me, and second, I'm here because the Lord has given me a word for you. I did not know they had a program coming on after I finished. And I will honor that as best I can. The word from the Lord comes from the book of 2 Timothy, a passage that the Lord has clearly laid on my heart for this evening. Second Timothy 4 and verse 2. Preach the word. As is so much the case in the Bible, profound and unforgettable truth appears in simple words. And if one is not reading the Bible, at least in second gear, you could shoot right by. Preach the word. And one is almost tempted to question the writer why such a mundane and simplistic statement. But because I have learned the Bible says nothing without cause or purpose, then the Holy Spirit, the author of Genesis through Revelation, must have sensed before he finished his work, the Bible, that maybe somewhere along the way, it would be necessary to say, preach the word. The fact that even this simplistic thought is introduced suggests that God sees it as important, and God would not say it if there was not a problem. Why address the obvious? If the word is being preached, then no need to say it. But if the imperative appears, then the Spirit of God must have sensed at some point, Brother Russell, that somewhere along the way, maybe there was some slippage. Somebody, Lord help us, was preaching something else besides the word. And so bothered by that, the Spirit could not turn loose of its sermon between Genesis and Revelation, for the Bible is one whole sermon. He could not get through his appeal. He could not get to his closure. He could not come to a summary without suggesting that a problem in the ministry needs to be addressed. What's the problem? Holy Spirit, they're preaching, but not the word. Now the word, a simple noun, not the words, the word, a holistic summary of Genesis to Revelation, implying that everything here needs to be discussed. Nothing here is irrelevant. Nothing here is old and outdated. Everything here needs to be preached. And notice the word preach. Not talked about. I wish somebody would listen to me this evening. Not mumbled, not carelessly suggested, but stand up, yes. Cry aloud, yes. About the word. Yes. And when you get started, don't stop till you've covered the whole thing. Yes. Don't just preach. Preach the word. Yes. All of it. Yes. Now you saying yes. But are you doing it? You see, Dr. Warren, I've been training preachers now for the past 30 years, and I've been visiting places and I preach, and sometimes I hear things from members of the church, and I'm beginning to wonder what's happening on Sabbath morning in some Seventh-day Adventist churches. What kind of verbal garbage and philosophical trash and almost complete stuff whipped up on Friday night is being presented to the saints. Saints that are tired, saints that are struggling, saints that are ignorant. Somebody needs to have the strength and the courage to stand up, prepared, prayed up, studied up, ready to go, and preach the word. Fifty-two Sabbaths at CPC, 104 opportunities, two services every Sabbath, and every other Sabbath a youth service, so another 26 in prayer meetings, another 26 opportunities to give the saints something they can live on and do with. And the Holy Spirit, Dr. Pettick, understanding the confluence of events, life and issues and stuff that can get in the preacher's way, understanding that sometimes your own life is your worst problem. You see, we preach to a problem we're a part of. We preach to people who sometimes know more than us. And we preach a subject we'll never understand. But in spite of that, we're called to preach it. And so the devil, knowing the command is there, knowing the enabling is there, works very hard during your week to make sure that this simple command is not obeyed. And so there you are on Friday night, scuffling up something. You've not touched a book since Sunday. And now you try to milk out of the Holy Spirit power he will not give. Because he says in John, I'll bring to remembrance. Well, if there's nothing there to remember, he cannot call up out of your empty brain a sermon on Friday night. The scripture is in the book of 2 Timothy. And scholars tend to agree. That was my introduction. Scholars tend to agree. Scholars tend to agree that 2 Timothy was Paul's last book. You will note that this injunction, preach the word, precedes this wonderful testimony. For now, I'm ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me, so on and so on. And so, it is in the context of this book, this last book that Paul is writing and the Spirit is ushering upon him, that this injunction comes to preach the word. And Paul is under now not house arrest, but he's in the penitentiary, he's on death row, and he's writing several letters, and he's getting out this information to this young preacher, the old preacher writing to the young preacher, and this gospel warrior now is saying to him, there's something you got to be sure that you don't stop doing. You gotta preach the word. And so while involved in this death wait, this time when the axe head will pass across his neck, he says to Timothy, you need to preach the word. In the first letter he writes to Timothy, the young pastor, he talks about general pastoral stuff and warns him of apostasy in the church. And by the time he gets to the second letter, he's more personal now. He's more concerned with reaching out to this fine young preacher. And by the time he gets to chapter 3, he sets his injunction in the context of the last days. See, first verse of 2 Timothy 3, this know also that in the last days perilous times shall come. And then he lists the problems in the church that will take place. And then he warns in verse 12, yea, all that live godly shall suffer persecution. But remember, this is in the context of the injunction to preach the word. Preaching the word will cost. And then he tells him in verse 14, continue thou in the things which thou hast learned and have been assured of. That is, preach the things you've been studying. I mean, how much confidence do you have in what you're preaching? You're a Seventh-day Adventist preacher. I'm an Adventist. I don't preach like anybody else. I'm an Adventist. I hear the sound of angels' wings already. I know the trumpet of God shall sound. I know the dead in Christ shall come up first. I know there'll be plagues and tribulations and earthquakes and pestilence. I know this. So as an Adventist preacher, one looking for the coming of the Lord, my preaching is different. It has an urgency and a power and a conviction. And I stand up with confidence that when I say something, I'm telling the gospel truth. I don't have to worry about anything going on in this book. I don't have to skip over anything that's here. I can preach Genesis to Revelation. I don't have to skip over the Sabbath. I can talk about the law. I can preach on the diet. I can talk about the tithe. I can deal with the state of the dead. There's no part of this Bible I'm afraid of because I'm a Seventh-day Adventist preacher. I don't run from any part of this book. I can pick up the whole thing and preach it, Steve, with great conviction. Why? I've been called to preach the word. I don't need that. Continue thou in the things you've learned. What kind of studying are you doing? Because that from a child thou hast known the scriptures and know they're able to make thee wise unto salvation. You see, you don't study the word just to produce sermons. You study the word to save your own sorry carcass from hell. And then because of what the word has done in your soul, you can't wait till Sabbath morning comes. You've already been washed by the word. You got something you got to say. The Holy Spirit can barely hold you in your seat. Let them get the prayer over. Let them get the ties lifted. Let them stop singing so I can get up and preach the word. You almost got to hold me back. I got to be patient while they mumble through the stuff they got to do and the announcements. I gotta pray for patience. Why? Because the word has washed me during the week, and by Friday night, I know me and God have got something to say. But that's because I've spent time with him. And you say, why are you preaching this kind of sermon to pastors? Because I keep telling you, I'm seeing a trend. I'm an Adventist preacher. I preach doctrine unapologetically. I believe in proof texts. I preach prophecy. I'm comfortable in Daniel, at home in Revelation. I can walk through the 2300 days without notes. Hallelujah. I can preach the seven churches. I can explain the seven seals. I know about those seven trumpets. I have seen Jesus coming in my vision. I understand that every time I preach, I'm preparing the way. I am that herald that prepares the way for the Christ to come. I'm comfortable in all those parts of the books that somebody says are mysterious and can't be understood. I know they can be understood because when you go to the Holy Ghost who wrote the book, he pours in your mind understanding of this stuff. I can preach. I'm a Seventh-day Adventist preacher. The sanctuary. I can explain that Jesus is now my high priest in glory. He's my advocate with the Father. Why? I'm a Seventh-day Adventist preacher. I got stuff I got to say. Don't have time to play around with little bit of stories and fancy philosophy and stuff that just makes folk feel good. I got to tell them that if they don't get straight, they're going straight to where they don't want to go. Why? I'm a Seventh-day Adventist preacher. I've not been called to entertainment. I've not been called to make folk feel good. Only good I can tell them that if you stand straight for God, he will blot out your sins. He will wipe out your past. He'll make it like you never committed a sin. I can tell them that. But I also got to tell them if you want to go to glory, you got to know the God of glory. I got to point out sin. I got to call sin by its right name. Why? I'm a Seventh-day Adventist preacher. Don't get me started, y'all. The word is first introduced in the book of Genesis. Preach the word. I'm enjoying myself. You know that? Preach the word. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And the earth was without form and void. Darkness was upon the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God moved. Now notice, nothing happens with the word until the Spirit of God moves. Yeah. And the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. And God said, let there be light. And there was light, and God saw the light that was good. And God divided the light from the darkness, and the light he called day, the darkness called he night. And the evening and the morning were the first day. Now notice, and God said, 8 times in the first chapter of Genesis, and God said. The Bible begins its sermon by explaining the power of the word. See, the word brings light where there's darkness. The word reaches into the vacuum of space and creates a firmament. The word brings dry land, something for me to stand on. Then the word bears fruit out of the dry land. And then the word puts the sun, moon, and stars for signs and seasons, so the word is a guide to me. Then the word brings life where there was no life, birds and fish. And then the word reaches and takes man and makes him into the image of God. And then the word rests me on the Sabbath. Somebody say amen out there. So the Bible begins with the indescribable majesty of the word. The word creates. And then he tells me, take this creative power and preach it. So when I preach, I expect light to come where there's darkness. Come on, somebody. I expect the vacuum of my saints to be filled by the firmament of his presence. I expect for the folks to find something they can stand on. I expect the word to be for signs and seasons. I expect the word to bring fruit and bring life. I expect the word to turn my sinning congregation into the image of God. Why? Because the word does that. Yes. Preach the word. Is anybody listening to me tonight? Yes. Are you ready to preach the word? Have you seen the word turn sinners into saints? Yes. Have you seen the word bring light where there's darkness? Yes. Have you seen the word put you on a dry land and rock to stand on? Have you seen the word create God's image in you? Yes. But then the Bible is not done discussing the word. In John 1, and verse 1, the Holy Ghost continues his sermon on the word. In the beginning was the word. And the word was with God. And the word was God. All things were made by him. And without him was not anything made which was made. Huh? The Bible now defines the word. The word was not comfortable being way up yonder. The word came down here. Dwells among men. That word is now flesh. Now watch me, preacher. The word becomes flesh. The word becomes flesh. The creative word becomes flesh. The word studied becomes flesh. The word memorized becomes flesh. The word preached becomes flesh. Your flesh, Brad, your flesh. When I preach this word, it gets inside of me and becomes flesh in me. That's why sometimes on Sabbath morning, I'm so filled up, the word is activating itself inside of me. It's changing the molecules of my sinful life. Hey! It's rearranging the atoms of discontent in my soul. The word is working on me even while I'm preparing the sermon. Sometimes I'm in my study and my fingers can't keep up with the Holy Spirit because the word is so powerful. The word is made flesh. Dwells amongst us. That's why the devil works so hard to keep you out of this book, because he wants the word. He doesn't want the word to do its work in you. You got to be what you preach, believe what you preach, live what you preach, sanctify what you preach. The word. The word now is Jesus walking around in me. I read Romans, the 8th chapter. What the law could not do in me, the Spirit through Christ now does in me. Are you listening to me? The reason why there's some weak, unproductive, inconsequential, forgetful, not worthy to be remembered sermons being preached on Sabbath morning is because somebody is standing up without connection to the living word. You see, I'm concerned. These are the last days. The seventh, don't get me started again, the Seventh-day Adventist preacher. That's a terrible fellow, the Seventh-day Adventist preacher. He's something else because he's so comfortable here. Seventh-day Adventist preacher. He grabs the book. There's nothing about it he's got to worry about. He just reaches down in here, and because he's spending time with the author of the book, he's God's special something in these last days. And you don't have to have a big church to preach the word. If you preach the word in a little church, it'll become a big church. I can testify. I can testify. I went to CPC with 27 folk. Now we got folks sitting on top of one another. It wasn't Henry Wright, but every Sabbath, woo, I'm preaching the word, the word. And folks sit there and they get to trembling. They try to stay in their seat and they got to get up. Why? It's the word. The person doing wrong sees right. The person not understanding the Sabbath suddenly sees the Sabbath and they can't resist the appeal of the evangelist. They come on down. Why? The man is up there preaching the word, and the word is bigger than the preacher. So the word in Genesis, the word in John, and the word over in 2 Timothy, preach the word. Let me show you something in this text, preach the word. 2 Timothy 4, I broke it down, preach the word, be instant. The Greek word means there, be pressing, be earnest, Murray Joyner. So you have to be serious. Do you understand the confluence of influences that are now pressing upon our people? Have you seen what's happening to the young people in the Seventh-day Adventist Church? I remember hearing the eminent Dr. Calvin Rock preach some years back that when an organization reaches the seventh generation from its roots, it begins to lose contact with those roots. If you trace our history from 1844, or if you trace our history from the year that the church was inaugurated in 1863, then we are either at the beginning or toward the middle of the seventh generation. And we have to keep preaching the stuff over and over again. Now, I'm all for, and some of you are great, you're great expositors of the stories and the parables, the incidents of the Bible, and breaking them down, so forth and so on. That's good, and it's wonderful. I don't want to discourage you from that. But brothers and sisters, listen to me. We need to be sure that the gravy is on top of meat. Do you hear me, Fred? You're getting ready to go back in the pulpit, man. And God has gifted you, but you got to be sure. Serve them gravy. Gravy is delicious. I don't particularly need it, frankly, myself. I'd rather have, you know, meat, but gravy is all right. But make sure beneath that gravy, you give the saints something that will build their soul in Christ. See, don't think for a minute. Three or four years ago, I did 13 sermons on the seventh-day Sabbath. in an Adventist church. But you see, I'm an Adventist preacher. And you see, what I like about the word, the whole word, see, you can't wear it out. Have you noticed? Every time you go back and preach a sermon on the Sabbath, you believe more on the Sabbath yourself. Because the word is a well without a bottom. So every time you drink that water, it gets sweeter. Come on, somebody. So don't think because you just ran an evangelistic series that you got it all hammered out. Go back and study the Sabbath for yourself and watch the Lord show you how much you don't know. I mean, just think about this. Just think about this. Ellen White says we will spend eternity studying the plan of salvation. That shows you how much we know now. You ain't near done. You got to go back again. Come on, somebody. You got to re-preach that law and re-preach that time. I guarantee you, you'll see something you haven't seen before. Preach the word. Now, if you want to rear back every now and then and preach one of them stories and talk about walking on water and all that kind of stuff, and I do it, that's fine, but that's good. And you want to serve them a whole meal of mostly gravy one Sabbath, fine. But the next Sabbath, come back and give them a meal with some cornbread and some broccoli and some corn on the cob. Some. Man shall not live by gravy alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Preach the word, be in season. The Greek word means there, timely. Be timely. You know, I like the way God helps us preachers. You know, we stumbling and bumbling along, and then he brings 911. Huh? Did we rear up? Come on, Adventist preachers, did we rear up? Yeah, we went back to Matthew 24, didn't we? Yeah, we preached the times and the sea. Every now and then the Lord lets something happen to remind you that you're a Seventh-day Adventist preacher. Be convenient. Out of season, that is unseasonable preaching, or the Greek says, preach the stuff that's not popular. You see, the church now increasingly is bound by sexual sins. You got to preach against that stuff. Hopefully, you can. You got to rear up and call sin by its right name. And even though your first elder might be uncomfortable, or your deacon might twitch in the seat, or your deaconess might drop her eyeballs, you got to keep on preaching what God says. Why? You're called to preach the word. In season, out of season, popular, unpopular, stepping on somebody's toes, stepping on your toes. Preach some fresh sermons on tithe. First, return your own. Because the Bible says, reprove and rebuke. The reprove and rebuke, the Greek says, expose. You got to expose stuff. And refute, encourage, call, admonish, exhort. And then it says sound doctrine, or the Greek says healthy stuff. You got to preach healthy stuff. Amen. You got to preach the health message. Amen. You got to preach the health message. Amen. You got to preach the health message. Got to preach the health message. Now I know, but it's time. How do you
going to tell your saints in the last days to give up flesh food and meat because of diseases and so forth, and you still chawing on that stuff? How you gonna lead your men to avoid prostate cancer, mainly caused by dairy and the diets of Black American men? We got to give up refined sugar. Keeps you all hyper and upset. You're not calm when you ought to be. Can't handle the board meeting because that sugar poison is all up in your system, and you're extra sensitive, and so you don't react like you ought to. You got to get your body clean so your brain can respond to the Holy Ghost. You got to get all that fat that's making your blood sluggish. Can't rise up in the morning and study because you're digesting the Kentucky Fried Chicken from last night. You got no time for the Lord. Somebody get this preacher out of the pulpit. You can do it. I'm a Seventh-day Adventist preacher. I'm a terrible fella. You give me a Bible and a text, I'll wear you out. Why? I'm a Seventh-day Adventist preacher. I hear the call of God, and I know I cannot shut up and keep silent like a fire. In my bones, I got to preach what God says. Because he told me. Preach the word. Back in the late 1700s, the Lord began to move. I'm going to wrap this thing up now. Lord began to move. The preaching of the word had become weak and spineless. Whole sections of scripture were being left out. A new concept had arisen called New Testament Christianity, the most unbiblical concept in the world. Because Jesus, who's the heart of the New Testament, used the Old Testament, didn't he? You've preached on Luke 24, 27, and beginning at Moses and all the prophets. He expounded to them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. So Jesus knew nothing about New Testament Christianity. And so the Lord needed to raise up a people. They begin to tap men like Joseph Wolfe and Louis Gwasson and Edward Irving, and they begin to preach the coming of the Lord. And then he tapped a Baptist preacher. So you got to remember that in the early days, Adventism was not a denomination. It was a movement. So I remember, Brad, in the old days, my grandfather, Grandpa Wright, who you knew, talked about the Advent movement. They never used the word denomination. Advent movement. Yeah, movement. Yeah, we are motel people. We just pausing here for a little overnight stay. And we know that one day, so we don't have time to get comfortable and posture in houses and cars. Advent preachers are not concerned about the size of the house and the kind of car. Advent preachers are not concerned about the size of the house and the car. Advent preachers are not concerned about the label in the suit. Advent preachers know that all that stuff is going to be burned up. So Advent preachers wear it loosely. If we have a nice house, we don't worry about it. We know it's just kindle for the fire. Drive a nice car, we know the Mercedes is just going to get the rest of everything set on fire and burn. We're not worried about labels because we're looking toward a robe that needs no cleaning and shoes that need no polishing. And hey, we're Adventist preachers. So he raised up these folk. And they begin to preach, he that shall come will come. Behold, they said, the bridegroom cometh. Go ye out to meet him. Now we know, we've studied the history. You don't need me to tell you, Advent preachers, that William Miller was mistaken about the date, but he was not mistaken about the fervor. Ellen White writes about the kinds of things that happened during that time. So believers were encouraged to work for their friends and relatives, and conversions were multiplying day by day. When Adventists believed in the Advent, Life Sketches, page 180, we were carefully scrutinized every thought and emotion of our hearts as if upon our deathbeds. We felt the need of eternal evidence, of internal evidence. We felt the need of internal evidence that we were prepared to meet Christ. Life Sketches, page 184. Every moment seemed precious and of the utmost importance to me. With deliberate searching of hearts and humble concession, we came prayerfully up to the time of expectation. When? Adventists, not Seventh-day Adventists, but Adventists. Sometimes we've gotten so hung up on the seventh day, we forget that we're also Adventists. Seventh day is good, but Adventists are people who are not landlocked. Adventists believe that human beings one day will fly. Adventists believe that the dead in Christ shall rise first. Adventists know that we don't have to worry about whether the next person who's the president is Obama, Sumbama, or D-Bama, because we know that Jesus Christ is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Adventist people, look through the trouble, look past the earthquakes, look beyond the hurricanes. We're not worried about that. We know that the Lord who brought this world in is the one who will take this world out. We're not worried about bombs and terrorists. We know that Jesus Christ is going to come himself, and the earth shall be burned up, the works therein. There's going to be a new heavens and a new earth. So we sleep at night. Let them attack. Let them plant bombs. We rest all night long. Why? We're Seventh-day Adventist preachers. And Adventists have a different view of the world. We're not upset about nothing. Let the stock market fall. I've placed my stock in heaven where moth and rust doth not corrupt. So he raised up these people from various Methodists, Baptists, Presbyterians, Church of Christ, Adventists, and then he coalesced them into a group. And our function, ladies and gentlemen, our function is to keep everybody on the planet directed toward things above. That's why we're here. We're such a marvelous church. Black folks and white folks and colored folks and striped folks and polka dot folks and nappy-headed folks and straight-haired folks and round-nosed folks and big lips folks and thin lips folks and Africans and West Indians and Chinese and Taiwanese and all the other knees. We don't worry about nothing because God is putting together a marvelous, miraculous people whom he has said, preach the word, all of it, without apology, with a great sense of destiny. And I appeal to you by the grace of God, stop fooling around in your pulpit, get up on Sabbath morning, tell the story of the Bible, preach the fresh things of God's word. Don't be afraid, your best days are ahead, your best sermons are ahead. Rise up with some confidence, and by the grace of God, preach the word.
Wow. Just Tested. Someone to say, wow. Wow, Elder. That's a word. That's a word. Wow. Let's pray. We thank you, God, for the word. But tonight, God, as preachers of the gospel, we stand convicted. Cause if truth were told, every last one of us have had moments walked in the pulpit where we had a word, but not the word. And right now, God, briefly, we confess it, we acknowledge it, and this is our humble commitment to you right now, God. You see our hearts, you see our home, our heads, and you see our passion. And right now, God, before you in this room, and the only person who knows is you, we give you our word, God, by your grace, that never again, someone shout, never again, will we walk back in that pulpit again, not prepared. And as the preacher said tonight, the preparation is not so much the preparation of the word, but allowing the word to prepare us. Where we're not preaching information, but we're preaching in the overflow of how God has already spoken to us. And God, I thank you for this very fundamental, basic, simple admonition tonight. It says, guys, it's a new day. And we believe that, Lord, every single Sabbath morning, there are people out there who are broken, they're hurting, they're confused, no clarity, trying to navigate life. And all they need is a word from the Lord. And Father, as an act of commitment, if you give us one more chance to make it back to Wednesday night and Sabbath morning, we're going to share the word, because the word has first found lodging place in us. For our prayer is in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, watch me, everybody. Listen to me. There's something unique that's about to happen. Why are we doing it tonight? Well, one of our guests, Dr. Barry Black, has a little job called the Chaplain of the United States Senate. And tomorrow morning, promptly at 10 o'clock, the Senate is going to open. And Chaplain Black is expected to open the Senate in the morning. He tried his best to work it. I offered to go open, but he wouldn't take my, ask me to go. But he has to fly out early in the morning to be back in Washington on Capitol Hill in the morning to open the Senate. So we're going to do this tonight. Our other guest tonight is Pastor Wentley Phipps, who was in Belgium over the weekend. And then he had to be in Missouri today. And so he flew straight here. We had a driver at the airport waiting for him to deplane to get right here. So what is going to happen tonight? Dr. Wilson is coming, and there's a very special interview tonight. As you know, that we had a pretty boring time planning for this evangelism council. Let the church say amen. Some of you just went right over your head. Let me try it again. It was interesting.